Well, so it's Amanda again with Unhinged Magazine, and we're here with Monte Warden. He's been hot and heavy on the music scene since about, 15 years old?
Yeah, since I was 15.
Right. So you were like doing some little honky-tonk bars and stuff performing back then. But this is the same Monte Warden of the internationally known country band The Wagoneers.
Yours with this little honk horn that you have, huh?
Delighted, Roy, delighted. Let her go, boys.
She's the best thing that ever happened to me. But lately she wouldn't know it, 'cause I haven't seen her and I haven't told her. I haven't been there to show it. I want to know her again.
That's me.
But he also has proven his amazing songwriting skills by making a successful career out of writing hits for country legends like George Strait. And I absolutely love George Strait. So you're my hero on that one.
On hits, here's George Strait.
It's the same. I hear you calling my name. You're lying next to me. I give in to your charms. You disappear in my arms. Realize it's just a dream.
Well, thank you.
So Monte's newest adventure brings us Monte Warden and the Dangerous Few. But get this, it's not country, it's jazzy. And I got your gift in the mail the other day. Thank you. So guys, this is coming out June 19th. I've already been listening to it on repeat. It has a strong set of tracks, amazing sound, funky vibes, and it's my new go-to to listen to while I'm cooking, just so you know.
Thank you. That's great.
So this record here, all 12 songs were recorded live, and I think I read wrong. Was it really only 2 days?
Yeah, 2 days. We caught, you know, because you've heard the record, Amanda. So that to capture that type of music, you almost have to record it live. You can't stack those tracks, and everybody's got to feed off one another. So the first day we got, I think, 8 tracks. And then the second day we got the other 4. And Brandy wanted us to, my wife and record producer, Brandy wanted us to go back and revisit the song Martini. She said, you know, we got Martini yesterday, but it's just not quite as good as the best it sounded at the Continental Club, so y'all go give it one more whack. And we took another whack at it, and we got it in one take. So we got 7 of the tracks you hear on the record the first day and 5 the second.
Perfect. I mean, that's impressive, especially with so many strong instruments involved, to be able to knock out a full album in just a couple of days with so many moving parts to it. I mean, that's really impressive, and it sounds amazing.
Thank you.
Your whole life has revolved around music. Did you ever think of what you might have done as a career if music had not been such an immediate and successful fit for you?
Oh, no, you've just terrified me. I've never considered what else. But really, like, music, like, saved my life. I came from not really the nicest people in the whole world, and so music was kind of an oasis for me. I could go up into my room and close my door and listen to my records and dream big dreams. And by the grace of God, I was talented enough to you know, make a living out of my dream. And I've always just love music. Music is the best friend I've ever had, you know.
Perfect. Yeah. So what inspired the shift in gears away from the country roots to this brand new sound?
Well, you know, I would say my primary focus has always been on songwriting, and I've always just been, had a deep affinity and respect for the music of that great American songbook era from the 40s to like the 60s. Songwriters like Johnny Mercer and Sammy Kahn and Harold Arlen and Burt Bacharach and Hal David. And so I was just, have always been drawn to just the beauty and artistry in those songs. But I never have written those types of songs. And about 5 years ago, really, I broke my leg and was laid up on the couch for 3-4 months and just started exploring, trying to write some songs with different chordal vocabulary and different lyrical vocabulary, and found that writing songs is just writing songs. Like, you know, the old saying, there ain't but 12 notes. So the music wasn't all that different, but the melodic relationship to chords and notes certainly were. But I found as soon as I wrote one good one, the second one came a lot easier.
Exactly. Yeah. So you've performed for years, and you've done tours and everything. What is something strange or even embarrassing or something that you might have had happen while like performing?
Oh, goodness. Got a minute? I'll tell you one thing. You know, it's funny you would say that. I was playing in, I think it was Detroit. It might have been Chicago. But I think it was Detroit. One of those places up in the Midwest where unions were very prevalent. And I just remember this. I'll never forget this. We were doing sound check, and one of the union guys said, "You got to be off the stage by 6:00. Stage goes dark at 6:00." And I said, "Well, we'll do our best." And the show was running late. The headliner for whom we were opening had run a little late, and so we were trying to get off stage. So our sound check didn't end until 6:00. And these union cats were so pissed at us, and we were just a bunch of kids. We weren't trying to be ugly or anything. And that night, when we went out to go do our show, all of our set lists had water poured on it and a big boot print right through our set list. So we hit the stage and didn't know what the hell we were going to do, except for the rest of my life, I knew to never offend the union guys. So that's one thing I remember. Let me see one other story. When I was like 16 years old, I was fixing to play this big show in Austin, and I was opening for Robert Gordon, a rockabilly singer. And my girlfriend thought she'd be a good girlfriend and write out our set list for us, and she wrote them in red ink. And unbeknownst to us, the filters on the lights on stage were red, and so as soon as we hit the stage, our set lists were invisible. So there's two horrific set list stories for you, Amanda.
Perfect. Yes. Those set lists, though, those are prized possessions of fans, too. So,
right. Fans are always trying to ask me for, can I have this? Like, yeah, of course. It's so funny. People love those, and I always try to hand one out after the show because people tend to dig those.
Exactly. Useless or strange talent?
I tell you what, I can set a fishing rig in less than a minute, but I don't have one here to demonstrate that, but I'm the king of setting a fishing rig very quickly.
What's your favorite type of fish to go after?
Oh, and you know, we like to creek fish here right close to the house. So cat and perch and bass, just whatever's swimming by in the creek.
Yeah, I got a big old pond. I'm usually out there almost every day, just wind down at the end of the day. So we have bass, crappie, brim. There's some carp in there, but I'm not messing with those things.
Well, but yeah. You know, I think carp get a bad name because they're so fun to catch because they put up such a fight. But, you know, it's like the old man for whom we named our youngest son, Brooks. He would, the way he described the Great Depression, he would say, "It got so bad, we were so hungry, we even ate carp." So that's how you know how bad it was. So, I love the fight that carp put up, but we just throw them back.
So what's your creative process like? I know we touched on it a little bit, but do you have like a standard, I'm going to sit down at this desk and I'm going to make myself come up with such and such, or is it you wake up in the middle of the night with an idea and you just run with it?
Oh, well, more the latter than the former. I mean, my creative process, I can't really command the mojo to show up when I'm sitting at my desk, but I do most of my writing with my wife, Brandy, and Brandy and I, we run every day at the state park that's just 2 miles from the house. And so often we'll start with an idea or just a little germination of a song, and I'll go off and run in one direction and she'll go off and run in the other. And when we meet back up, we'll see who has something. And we always know if the person comes up and they're waving their index finger in the air, it means somebody had something. And then we'll go home. from the part, get cleaned up, and I'll sit down with the guitar and see if they're, what chords or melody structures are wanting to find themselves in that song.
That's perfect. That's unique. Yeah. I used to be big into running, and that's when I always had the most clarifying aha moments, you know, for everything. So that's cool. I've never heard that before. Well, speaking of these times, how has the pandemic affected you music-wise? Have you had to cancel things? Has it slowed down releases or anything?
Well, we, you know, like, you know, every other picker in the world, we lost every gig overnight. But I will say this, we didn't slow down the release of the record. We just went straight ahead with it. It's going to be June 19th. And we have certainly found ourselves listening to more music throughout this. So I reckon everybody else want to also. And the project itself, you've heard the album. It lends itself to feeling good and optimism. And I think it's good timing in that regard. But well, one thing that I'll say is, because music's all I've ever done, so uncertainty, financial uncertainty, I've known my whole life since I was 14. So really, the rest of the world is kind of experiencing all I've ever known. And I'm 39 years in to being very familiar with economic uncertainty. So this is just a normal thing for me. If all the gigs go away, okay, we'll figure something else out. And by the grace of God, something I never would have done were live streams. And we've been doing one every Friday. I call it the Monte Warden Feel Good Hour on Facebook. And it has been a financial miracle to our family. It's been a spiritual miracle to our family, just the way to stay connected, reconnect with our fans and our audience and our family members that I never would have done if this tragedy hadn't befallen our times. And I'm going to keep doing them forever. These live streams have been just an amazing thing. Because, you know, Amanda, if I'm picking Friday, whether, you know, I'm in North Carolina or Texas or New Mexico or wherever, I can only be in that one spot. But with these live streams, I can be in everybody's living room. So it has certainly been a real, real blessing for us. But, you know, in regards to the other things going on, everyone in our family and in our universe is healthy and blessed, and we have certainly known more sunshine than not throughout this thing.
Good, that's perfect. Yeah.
How about y'all? Is everybody healthy in your world?
Yes. Thankfully so. And I'm an essential employee, so I've still been having to go out to work every single day too. So, and I've managed to stay out of the harm's way. So. Talk about anything else you have coming up. I mean, are we going to have more of Monte Warden and the Dangerous Few in the future, or what's your future looking like?
Well, God, man, can I put this first record out for a minute and just enjoy?
I'm just saying, I'm excited. I'm so excited. I'm just like, I want more of this.
Well, me too. And seriously, I reckon we've probably got 6 or 8 definite just A-listers. I don't mean things left over that we didn't record. I mean things we've written since we've recorded the project that just sound wonderful. I love writing in this genre, in this vein. And for me, because I've always made my living as a honky-tonk singer or a rockabilly singer, those were already tried and true genres. The cool thing about the Dangerous Few, as you know from having heard it, if it catches on, there's only one place to go get it. So I definitely think there will be another Dangerous Few record. Probably we'll start thinking about going in the studio, I reckon, probably early next winter, something like that. But I'm just so blessed and loving doing presenting these songs to people. So far, the reaction has been more than I could have hoped for, and I've hoped for a lot of good stuff.
Perfect. Awesome. Well, thanks again for meeting with me.
Thank you. And don't be a stranger. If you're, when things go back and you're coming this way, please let Brandy and I would love to buy you some Tex-Mex.
Oh, that sounds amazing. I've never actually been down there, so I would love that.
We would love to show you around. My family has only been in Texas every single day since 1832, so we'd love to show you around.
That sounds like a shindig. I'm looking forward to that. So
we would love it, and thank you, and y'all stay healthy.
We will. You do the same. Thank you again, and we'll talk soon.
I look forward to it. Thank you, Amanda.
Bye.